About 400 years after King David died, four nations drove most of the Israelites out of the Promised Land. It was a difficult time for the nation of Israel. They struggled to follow God while living away from home and longed to return. But a few men and women were so committed to God's ways that they found favor with the kings and rulers of the countries they lived in and were given important positions. One of these was a man named Daniel. The king of Persia, Darius, was so impressed with Daniel's leadership that he appointed him to be one of 120 leaders to oversee the Persian kingdom. In fact, Daniel was such a good leader that a few of the other leaders became very jealous. They devised a plan to have Daniel killed. The leaders went to the king saying, "May King Darius live forever. We have all agreed that you should decree that anyone who prays to any god or human being other than you for the next 30 days should be thrown into a den of lions." Not realizing what it would mean for Daniel, Darius put the law into writing. When Daniel heard about the law, he went to an upper room in his house where the windows faced Jerusalem. Three times a day, Daniel bowed and prayed to God. When the Persian leaders saw Daniel praying to God, they went straight to the king. They told the king, "Daniel, one of the Israelites, pays no attention to you or to the decree you put in writing. He still prays three times a day." When King Darius heard this, he became distraught and tried to figure out a way to rescue Daniel. At sundown, King Darius realized that he could not save Daniel, so he ordered Daniel to be thrown into a den of lions. Just before lowering him inside, the king said to Daniel, "May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you." They threw Daniel into the den and placed a stone over the opening to seal it. The king returned to his palace, refusing any food or entertainment. That night, he could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king rushed to the lion's den. Standing near the den, he called out, "Daniel, has your God been able to rescue you from the lions?" Then Daniel answered, "May the king live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the mouths of the lions." King Darius was filled with joy and ordered his guards to lift Daniel out of the den. When he came up, Daniel was unhurt. Finally, the king commanded that the men who had falsely accused Daniel be thrown into the lion's den themselves. "May you prosper greatly," the king said to Daniel. "I issue a decree that in every part of my kingdom, people must worship the God of Daniel, for he is the living God and endures forever."
I know this has been a pretty busy week for birthdays and anniversaries. All right, and we can't recognize everybody's, but I've had several people tell me, "Hey, did you know this was somebody's first anniversary?" If it's your first anniversary, stand. All right, first anniversary. Come on, be proud. All right, good. All right. Congratulations. Here we go today. Fawn, did she sneak out the back door? All right, she's going down the side. Tell my older adopted sister that happy birthday today. All right, it's her birthday. Somebody 80 today? Raise a hand. There we go. Right, come on, raise a proud. 80 and strong. Had the privilege of baptizing him just 2 weeks ago. That was great fun. Thank you. So, anybody else have a birthday this weekend? Dawn? Shelly? My much younger bride. She forced me to say that. anyway, great to have you here today. 70s? 90? Woo! Way to go, girl! All right, is everybody relatively comfortable? Oh, hi, there's Fawn. All right, happy birthday, Fawn. We're just saying happy birthday anniversary. Do you notice we kind of have that leopard thing going on stage today, too? If I'd have known that, I would have got my spots on. All right, you didn't plan it. All right. Is everybody comfortable? Is it a little warm? Warm? More? Okay. I'm a little, okay. Should we crank? Not the outside ones, but the inside units down just a little bit. The one on the inside here and the one on the inside there. Just take us down a hair. And if you all start getting too cold, somebody raise your hand or snuggle to the person next to you. Introduce yourself if you don't know them first, though, okay? Imagine a group of people coming to your home and interrupting your popcorn-eating, TV-watching routine with an urgent message. Hey, good news, guys. We're from the United States Olympic Committee. We've been looking for somebody to run the marathon at the next Olympics. We have statistics on every person in the entire nation on our computer. We have checked everybody's records, their performance in the president's fitness test in grade school, body type, bone structure, right down to the current percentage of body fat. We have determined that out of 200 million people, you are the one person in America with a chance to bring home the gold in the marathon. So you're on the squad. You'll run the race. This is a chance of a lifetime. You are surprised by this announcement because the farthest thing that you have ever run is from your couch to the refrigerator. But when the shock finally wears off, you are gripped by the realization of what's happening in your life. You picture yourself mingling with elite athletes from all around the world. You even allow yourself for a moment to imagine that maybe you do have what it takes. At night, you start dreaming about standing on the podium after the race and hearing our national anthem, seeing the flag raised, and bending low for the gold medal to be placed around your neck. You begin to feel a sense of urgency within you. It's going to be your body wearing those racing togs, and a billion people will watch you on TV. But greater than any external pressure is now this internal drive that says, this is the race I was created to run. This is my destiny. This is why I was born. Here is my chance to fulfill my purpose. This race becomes the great passion of your life. It dominates the thinking of your mind. It occupies every waking moment to run the race, to win it if you can. It becomes the central focus of your existence. It's what drives you out of bed in the morning. It is what you live for. This is the chance of a lifetime. And then it dawns on you. Right now, you cannot run a marathon. By the way, they're running one right now across the Twin Cities here, all right? More to the point, you cannot run a marathon if you really even tried hard. Trying hard can accomplish only so much. But if you are serious about seizing this chance of a lifetime, you must choose to enter a life of training and discipline. You must arrange your life around certain practices that will enable you to do what you cannot do right now by sheer willpower. When it comes to running a marathon, you must train, not merely try. Listen to what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 through 27, when Paul said this, "Do you not know that in a race, all of the runners run?" That just sort of seems logical, doesn't it? If you're in a race and you're running, you all run. But only one gets the prize. Run in such a way as to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into very strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last. But we do it to get a crown that will last forever. Therefore, I do not run like somebody who runs aimlessly. I do not fight like a boxer who's shadow boxing. No, I strike a blow to my body and I make my body my slave so that after I have preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified from the race. I got home just in time to watch the Breeders' Cup yesterday. Just in time. Opened the gates as I walked in the door. And I watched those horses run around the track. And I saw the one which won. I was rooting for Chrome. Third by a nose and a half. The guy who won was excited, and then all of a sudden they hear the news. A protest has been filed. They went back to the beginning of the race where just as he got out of the starting gate, he kind of went errant. He kind of went off path. He sort of ran aimlessly to the pole. They had to decide, did this disqualify him? Paul gives you and I the same warning. Be careful what you say if you're not prepared to live what you believe. Because if you tell folks what you believe and you live a different way, you may bring disqualification in that set of circumstances, and that is not good for anybody. Throw a diagram up on here, if you will, please, just for a brief moment. The key beliefs that were covered in the last section drive the outcome of who we become. However, there's a difference between believing something as the right answer and believing something as the way of life. The first resides in our head alone. I believe this, I believe this, I believe this. That's head knowledge. But how do you live your life? Do you live your life on what you believe up here? Or do you live your life, as the Bible says, with everything that proceeds out of your heart? How many times have you seen folks make a decision? How many times have you made a decision? Well, it felt like the right thing to do. And how many times when you said, I felt like it was the right thing to do, did you come to regret what you felt was right that day, you discovered was wrong weeks and months later? You see, we've got to transport biblical beliefs 12 inches from our head to our heart. We've got to move them from things that we just think about to actions that we actually practice. The primary means is through engaging in biblical practices. In this diagram, there must be the presence of God in the center of our life. We can call that the throne of our life. Once we have God living within us, we now can begin to think, what are the truths that we build our life and our faith on? And that is what we spent the previous 10 weeks looking at in the Believe series. Looking at the 10 key truths out of the Bible, the most important truth that is the solid foundation for us to build our life and our families on. And what we are kicking off today is moving from the truths to the practices. How do we take those truths, which we can come to say, I believe that in my mind, how do those truths become fleshed out in the way in which I live my life? How does it become relevant like it was for David standing here when he says, now, I no longer think about praying about decisions. I actually now, most of the time, really do that. That is taking truth to practice. And that's what we want to do. So with the presence of God on the throne of our life, we first of all have to think, what are those truths? And then we must act upon those truths that we say we believe in. How do we do that? You can take that away. I don't know if that helped, but I had fun making it. You see, the primary means of going from head to heart is engaging in biblical practices. It's getting off the couch. I can believe on the couch I'm destined to run a marathon. I can dream on the couch of standing on the podium and receiving a medal. But until I put into practice some disciplines in my life, I will never even run the marathon. Paul views these practices in the Scripture as spiritual disciplines. And as a believer engages in spiritual practices and disciplines consistently and routinely, here's one just to toss out. Forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. You've done that today. Routinely and consistently. This transformation occurs in our life from a couch potato to a marathon runner day by day. I got news for you. You don't go from couch potato to gold medal winner in one day, in one week, in one month. This is a day-by-day routine, consistent process so that spiritual muscles are formed, so that spiritual lungs can expand, and so spiritual hearts pump stronger. We cannot bring about inner transformation on our own. The living presence of the Holy Spirit within our human spirit empowers us as we yield to the influence and the coaching of Christ in our lives. Because He and the person of the Holy Spirit now lives within our hearts. That is what Paul wrote in Galatians. Christ in you, the hope of all glory. Because He resides in our spirit, He bypasses all the layers of complexities where excuses and rationalization creeps in, and God speaks directly to our heart. Is anybody cooling off yet? Okay, I'm glad you all are, because I'm not. I'm hot. Okay. Is my shirt ironed? Okay. Just this week, I had an appointment with a gentleman. Hadn't seen in quite a while. Go back several years. This was a gentleman I've known for a long time. I love him. Reminds me of one of my uncles. And he was going through, several years ago, he was going through some very, very difficult times, personally, family-wise, professionally. And he wanted to meet. And so it started out for just a month or two. I ended up meeting with him for 3 years, almost every Thursday or Saturday mornings every week. We did Bible study together. We did devotional studies together. We talked about his issues, how God wanted to work in his life. At the end of 3 years, I never had been able to get him engaged in a group study. Never get him engaged to come to church. There was always this list of excuses of why. Finally, about the end of 3 years, I said, "Okay, I can't keep doing this on a weekly basis. Give me a call when you got something." Well, several years have now passed, and I got a call from him. And we set up a time to meet this week. And I sat with him and I listened to him. And I know you'll find this hard to believe. I did not say one word for 45 minutes. I just sat. I listened. A lot of it was things we'd already been over and new stuff kind of in the same genre. When he finished, I said, "I got just one question. Just one. Thank you for sharing. I love you. I do. I've been praying for you these last several years. But I have one question. How is your personal relationship with Jesus Christ? You've told me about all of your other relationships and all of your other adventures, but here's what I want to know. What is your relationship with Jesus Christ like?" For the next 10 minutes, I got excuses and rationalizations. "You don't know how many hypocrite Christians I know. You have no idea how my mother tried to cram this down my throat when I was a kid." I listened for 10 minutes and I said, "How would you like for me to view my opinion of you based on what other folks that you have talked to me about would tell me about you?" "Oh, I wouldn't like that." "Then Jesus doesn't like you to form an opinion about him based on what others might have to say about him. He would love for you to find out about him all on your own. And I've given you," and I quoted some other materials, I said, "that we've gone through. What have you done? How have you engaged?" And earlier he had said, "Every morning I get up, I throw my head up and say, 'Thank you for another day.'" And I said, "Why now?" Then I said, "Okay, why do you say thank you? If he's not worthy of your thanks, and he's not worthy of a relationship, why thank him? What has he given you?" And God drove home through a real life illustration how you and I do that. We make excuses and rationalizations to God about why we don't have a healthy relationship with Him, why we don't practice these disciplines that are so important for our health and for our growth. Right beliefs in the mind need to become outward expressions from our heart. Jesus used the analogy of the vine-branch relationship in the Gospel of John chapter 15 to explain this inner transformational process that takes place in our lives. When we accept Christ and receive Christ in our lives, we are reconciled to God. That was one of our studies. Remember? Salvation. How we come into a right relationship with the God who wants to be personal and He wants to have this relationship with us. And the Scripture says that there's a bunch of branches out there. All right? It says that Gene is a branch and that Dennis is a branch. and it says that Tim is a branch, and it says that Linda is a branch, and it says that Mary is a branch, and it says that Fawn is a branch, and y'all are just kind of loose branches hanging out there in the world. And all of a sudden you come to discover your life is going to pass, and nothing of value is going to last. And so we say, I'd like to have a relationship with the vine, for it lives forever. And we acknowledge our need, and God picks up this loose branch named Gene, and he grafts it into the vine. And he takes this loose branch named Fawn, and he grafts her into the vine. And you know what? For a little period of time, they may not look real good. Nothing personal. Okay? You're not healthy yet. You've now been plugged into a life source. How does the life of that vine function in the branch? We're grafted in. As we obey the commands and the truths of Jesus, as we put into practice our beliefs, then the nutrients from the root that is deep in Christ Jesus are transferred into our branches, and eventually, in time, rich, plump, tasty grapes appear on the end of our branches. And if you want to know what that looks like, go to the book of Galatians and read the passage on the fruit of the Spirit, and it will tell you your life will now begin to show love and gentleness and kindness and meekness. And some of you are going to say, that's just not my personality. And you're absolutely right, it isn't. But it is his personality. And if you have been grafted into him, his personality will eventually begin to be expressed through yours. And it's called his character. As we move from our study of key truths to key practices and disciplines, we will be introduced to the top 10 key practices of the Christian life. We spent 10 weeks, if you're new here today, we spent 10 weeks looking at the key truths of the Bible. What do you build your life on? And now, number one, we are going to look at the 10 key practices that stem from those 10 key truths that will eventually enable us to run the marathon without disqualifying ourselves or others in the race. As we move from key truths to key practices, we will discover how we build on a solid foundation and grow healthy from discipline. Together, these two things answer the question, what should I do with my life? Each subject that we will look at for the next 10 weeks, we will address three areas. Key question, key idea, key application. The key question under each chapter is something like this. What life question does this practice answer? Key idea will be something like this. What are the essentials of engaging in this spiritual practice? And key application, what difference does this make in the way in which I live my life? You see, spiritual exercising can be as challenging as physical exercising, but the outcome is undeniably beneficial. The spiritual fitness coach of the New Testament, the Apostle Paul, he offered this inspirational word to pump up a young preacher by the name of Timothy. And here's what he said to him in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 8 and 9. He said, physical training is of some value. How many of you agree with that? That's a real question. How many of you, a little physical, how many of you don't want to commit to any physical training? Okay, yeah. What he's telling you is, physical training is not a waste of time. There is value in physical training. But, godliness has value for all things. Physical training will help you till the day you die, and then that's through. It's finished. It's done with. All right? But godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both this present life and the life to come. This thing called eternity that we talked about last week. You and I practice the disciplines of the truths that we believe, and it benefits us both now and in the future. What David just testified about, it helps him now, and it also is good preparation for the future. And Paul goes on to say to this young preacher, this is a trustworthy saying, and it deserves half-hearted acceptance. No. What he said was, this deserves full acceptance. Nothing short than I believe that with all of my heart. I believe it that I want it to go from my head to my heart so it represents the way in which I live. As we learn about these amazing life-giving spiritual disciplines, embrace them in our hearts. Make it our goal to strap on our spiritual tennis shoes, and let's give all 10 of these disciplines a try. And here's the first one. Key practice, key discipline number one is worship. Did you have any idea that's where we were going today? All of you should have, because how many of you read chapter 11 before you got here today? Okay, all right, good. That's a little better than last week. All right, I'm proud of you. If you don't have a Believe book, you may pick one up out there in the pavilion after the service. $10, $5 are free. You choose the price. Isn't that a great way to sell things? I love it. Here's what David said in Psalm 95. Come, let us sing for the joy of the Lord. That's what we just sang about today. Come, let us worship together. Let us shout aloud to the rock of salvation. Let us come before him with what kind of attitude? Thanksgiving. Not grumbling. And let's extol him with music and with song. A simple definition I would like to share with you this morning for the practice of worship is this: attributing worth to someone or something. So the question for you is, who or what are you attributing highest worth and highest value to? Worship is not an earthly event that we attend. It is rather a heavenly activity in which we take part. As Christians, in our personal and in our corporate worship, and there should be and there must be both in our lives. It must be personal and it must be collective. As we worship the one true God, we are attributing or ascribing to him the worth he deserves and to him alone. If you were to compare... Okay, let me not pick any of my favorites. This side, one person, whoever's the loudest, I'll take your answer. Who is your favorite baseball player? Posey. Okay, thank you for that answer. Oh, that was a good one. No partiality, though you guys cannot probably equal that current player today, but that's all right. It doesn't have to just be current. Past as well, too. Man, ooh. He was my favorite. No, don't even mention an Oakland A's guy. Okay, all right, so we got Posey and we got Mantle, okay? You and I could debate back and forth the worthiness of each of those as a great baseball player, couldn't we? You could have good arguments for both of them. Now I'm going to ask you to make this comparison. Compare the worth of God to your job. Anything close? Compare God to your favorite hobby. Compare God to your spouse. To your child. To your parents. Any debate? The question is, by the practice of your life, would others know who you worship as God? By your life, is it evident who is worthy of the worship of your life? What you believe here and what you express from here. As Christians who say that we believe God is who he said he was, did what he said he would do, we are believing in him and communicating to him that God, you alone are worthy. Over 40 years ago, a pastor and an author by the name of A.W. Tozier made this statement. He said, worship is the missing jewel of the evangelical church. A.W. Tozier is dead now. But I wonder if A.W. Tozier showed up again for just a brief period of time, I wonder if he would notice any improvement in the church in finding the jewel which seems to be missing. Technology, it is a whole lot different than it was 40 years ago in public worship. But is worship any better? Performance is up! But Sunday after Sunday, is worship up? Diversity in worship is much broader. But is our worship any greater? Maybe if we can understand what worship is, we can more effectively answer the question. When you hear the word worship, what pops in your head? When somebody says, hey, we got to go to worship today, what pops in your head? Is there the singing of a certain kind of music? And most of us would say, the singing of my kind of music. Is it the wearing of my kind of clothes to church? Is worship bowing my head and closing my eyes? Or is it raising my hand and opening my lips? Is worship done standing, sitting, kneeling? Can worship be done while I'm laughing? Or is it more spiritual when I'm crying? Whatever else the word worship suggests to you in your own experience and expression, this word should speak powerfully about our own response to God. It is focused on a relationship, not on an environment. You see, worship is an active response to God whereby you and I declare His worth. And we do this privately and we do this publicly. Worship is not passive. It is to be participative. Worship is not just a feeling. This is a decision. Worship is not simply a mood. This is a response. I don't know if you all noticed what I did as I was writing those things out. Worship is a lot like love and marriage. You see, this is a relationship. This is not an institution. This is an active response to God whereby we declare His worth. Worship and love and marriage are not to be passive events, but participative events. Sometimes you get passive in marriage, don't you? You've heard the story, but forgive me for telling it again. I'm almost 60, you know. I can tell things over and over again now. Couple have been married 50 years, and they go in to see their pastor, and the pastor said, of all the couples of church, you're the last couple I ever expect to make an appointment for me about marriage counseling. What seems to be the problem? And the husband goes, hey, I'm with you, pastor. I thought everything was just fine. I thought we had a great marriage. He looks at the wife, and the wife looks at the pastor, and the husband says, he doesn't love me anymore. And the husband looks at her and says, what in the world don't you mean I love you anymore? She said, you have not told me you love me since the day we got married. He said, of course I haven't. I haven't changed my mind. There's a passive man, all right? It's a passive man. It's to be participatory. It's to be responsive. This is not just a feeling. This is a decision. Love is not just a feeling. It's a choice that we make. In translating the word from its biblical roots in the English, the translator settled on the word worth-ship. When we say about somebody, he worships his money, or we say about a mama, she worships the ground her children walk on, we could be using that word a little bit too loosely. But if, however, the fact is that the supreme worth for that businessman is his money, and if for that mom the highest value of her life is her children, then we're using that term accurately. In Great Britain, England, where this term worth-ship came to be, the honorific title used to describe the leading citizen of a town is, let me introduce you to his worship, the mayor. In our country, we've kind of filtered that down a little bit, and we say, let me introduce to you his honor or her honor, the mayor. To worship someone or something is to attribute the supreme worth, to declare the supreme value to one person or to one thing. And along this thought process, Ralph Martin writes, to worship God is to ascribe to Him supreme worth, for He alone is worthy. What is the essence of worship? I believe it is the celebration of God. When we worship God, whether privately or whether publicly, we celebrate Him. We boast to Him and about Him. We sound out aloud His praises. Author Ronald Allen, in a book that he wrote, thought the same way when he penned these words. He said, worship is not casual chatter that occasionally drowns out the prelude music. We celebrate God when we allow the prelude to tune our hearts to the glory of God. Worship is not the mumbling of prayers or the mouthing of hymns with little thought and less heart. We celebrate God when we join together earnestly in prayer and intensely in song. Worship is not self-aggrandizing words or boring cliches when one is asked to give a testimony. We celebrate God when all the parts of the service fit together and work for a common end. Worship is not grudgingly giving gifts or compulsory volunteer service. We celebrate God when we give to Him hilariously and we serve Him with integrity. Worship is not haphazard music done poorly. It's not even great music done merely as performance. We celebrate God when we enjoy and participate in music for His glory. Worship is not a distracted endurance of the sermon. Seeing if you're awake. We celebrate God as we hear His word gladly and we seek to be conformed by it more and more so we reflect the image of His Son and our Savior. Just as a thoughtful gift is celebration of a birthday, as a special evening out is a celebration of an anniversary, as a warm life eulogy is a celebration at a memorial service, as a sexual embrace is a celebration of marriage, worship service is a celebration of God. So the key question, how do I honor God in the way He deserves it? When we worship God for who He is, simultaneously expressing what we believe. We've been looking at that. When we worship God, for being personal, for providing salvation, for giving to us His word so we can know His thoughts, for Him giving to us our identity in Christ, we're no longer sinners but saints. When we recognize God as head of His body called the church, when we recognize that God loves all humanity and wants to love them through us, when we say that we believe and now we practice compassion as we share that love with others, when we believe that God is the owner of all things and that He lets me be the manager of it, and that's called stewardship, when we believe that God has provided a way for us to live with Him forever, and that is eternity. As we can clearly see through these connections, there's a deep intertwine of key beliefs and key practices. Worship is the first spiritual discipline of a Christ follower, and it helps the key beliefs move from our mind to our heart. Just going to give you a tip for the future. What was key truth number one? God. Key practice number one? Worship. Do you see something there? Who do we worship? God for who He is. I believe God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and I worship Him. Next week, we're going to look at a personal God. And what's next week's subject? Prayer. How do we have a personal relationship with somebody? We talk to them. We listen to. Are you seeing a picture? Just a little suggestion. See how those follow up. Key idea, I worship God for who He is and what He's done for me. When Jesus encountered the woman at the well in Samaria, a conversation towards worship was developed. Sir, the woman said, I can see you are a prophet. Our ancestors worship on this mountain, but Jews claim the place we must worship is in Jerusalem. Sounds a little legalistic, huh? You just can't worship God anywhere. Woman, Jesus replied, believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father, neither on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritan worships what you do not know, and that was right. They worship whatever popular God was functional at the moment. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews, yet a time is coming, is now come, that the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. For God is Spirit, and His worshipers must worship Him in spirit and in truth. The truth being our mind, the Holy Spirit being in our spirit, so directing our behavior that the truth in our mind becomes functional out of our heart, and we worship God as a result of that influence in our life. Jesus is stating that worship is not about being at a precise geographic location, but rather having intimate spiritual longing with Him. God seeks worshipers who, through the power of His Spirit, will attribute worth to Him in any location and for the right reasons. Because Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. The psalm refers often to our worship of God for who He is and what He's done. Psalm 29:2, ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Psalm 95:6 says, come, let us bow down in worship, kneel before the Lord, for He is our God and we are His people. A man told a story about the time his son was going to turn 6 years old. The son had mentioned to his dad that he wouldn't mind a birthday party. His son was usually very specific about the things that he wanted. He was pretty anal for six. He sat down with his son and he asked his son, what would you really like to have for your birthday? The son looked at his father and said, I'd like a ball to play with. That kind of caught his dad off guard because he didn't say what kind of ball and where he could get it. This was a son who would usually say, hey, I want a baseball glove. You'll find it at Toys R Us, aisle 6, second shelf, right below the bats. His son was just that precise. So he said, son, I need a little more help. Can you tell me what kind of ball would you like? And the son said, oh, dad, I don't know, either a football or a soccer ball. Dad, wanting more definitive answer, said, son, which one would you like most? And the son thought about it for a minute, and he said, Dad, if you have time to play ball with me this year, I'd really like a football so we can play in the backyard. You could teach me how to throw and teach me how to catch. But, Dad, if you're going to be really busy this year, then I'd rather have a soccer ball because I can play with my friends down the street. Dad didn't ask any more questions. He slipped out of the room and he slipped into the kitchen with his wife and he expressed to her the conversation that it had. And with her wisdom, they both concluded the fact that their son was not interested in the type of ball. He wasn't as interested in the gift as he was spending time with the giver. God is looking for that kind of response from us. Do we want to spend time with the giver? While worship is deeply personal, the practice is an ongoing activity of the fellowship called the church. If you've ever stood among a group of sold-out saints lifting up songs together, you know how powerfully individual hearts can unite and create a cathedral no matter where they are. What's the key application? What difference does this make in the way in which I live? One, we should daily acknowledge God for who He is and what He's done. That's the personal side of this. Every single day. Every single day we ought to be engaged. We're married. I love telling her every day that I love her. I love hearing back from her that she loves me. That's not just a on Sunday event. That's a daily event. In fact, there's a little banter that goes on. If either one of us have sort of forgotten it for part of the day, we'll send a text or get a text that says, you haven't told me something today. Oh, yeah. Good reminder. Okay? Because here's what happens. Days become weeks, and weeks become months, and months become years. And that same thing happens with us and God. Daily acknowledge Him. And then there are moments that we get to acknowledge it publicly. Like I get to a church to tell you, hey, babe, I love you. Usually that's because I'm making up for something I messed up during the week, and so trying to get extra points. Number two, we worship God privately and corporately with songs we sing, with words we speak, and with the way we live our lives. And then when we attribute worth to God as a child of God, unmerited worth is attributed back to us. I know of nobody else who does this but God. When we give to Him what He deserves, He gives to us what we don't deserve. He gives to us His value. He gives to us His love. He gives to us His admiration for us when we give to Him what He really does deserve. Since the fall of mankind in the Garden of Eden, the greatest struggle that humanity has had is wanting to be God. While most of us don't wish to have the responsibility and the burden of calling the shots for all the world, we do want to be God of our own lives, to do what we want, when we want, where we want, with who we want. Here is why worship is so important. When we engage in the practice of worship, we crawl off the throne of our life, where God ought to be, and where we don't belong, and we should crawl onto the altar of God where we do belong and fulfill what Paul said in Romans, I present my body as a living sacrifice. We need to be on the altar and He needs to be on the throne. The quite amazing exchange when we surrender control and attribute worth to God is that He in turn gives to us His worth. Worship expresses a relationship we have with God. And get this, the stronger the relationship and the deeper the intimacy, the greater the worship. I don't know about you, but I would rather rest in the fact that I'm a child of God than I had wear myself out trying to be God. To receive the blessing that He does intend for me rather than to bear the burden that He never intended for me. Let me wrap this up with one more biblical story. 2 Samuel chapter 6, we read the story of David as he visits Obed-Edom's house to retrieve the Ark of the Covenant and to return the Ark back to Jerusalem where it's supposed to be. The Ark had kind of been banished from the heart of the nation of Israel. And the ark represented the presence of God in the nation of Israel. And it was supposed to be in the temple in Jerusalem, all right? The center, the hubbub, just as God is to be on the throne of our life. That is where the ark of the covenant was supposed to be. And it wasn't there. They had sent for it once, and they didn't do it the way God wanted them to. And so some tragedy. So they just left it. Doesn't that often happen in your life? Tragedy strikes, and you just leave God right there. Instead of finishing the process, instead of seeking His will and His wisdom, we just... David finally retrieves it, has it brought back properly. As he sees the ark entering the city, David throws off all of his garments of being a king, his robe, and I don't know if he wore a crown, but everything that let everybody else know that David was the king, he threw it all. David stripped to his underwear. It's found, if you want to read it, in 2 Samuel 6, 14 through 17. It says he was wearing a linen ephod, and he was dancing before the Lord with all of his might, while he and all Israel were bringing the ark of the Lord with shouts and the sound of trumpets. And as the ark of the Lord was entering the city, Michal, daughter of Saul, the previous king, okay, who David replaced. I think Michal, the daughter's a little miffed. She's not living in the White House anymore. So she's a little ticked at David. She's not even paying any attention to why David is doing what he's doing. She just has something against David. What does the scripture say? When she saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord, she despised him in her heart. They brought the ark of the Lord and set it in its place. And David sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before the Lord. David's deep respect, awe, joy, gratitude, and relief at God's blessings overwhelmed him to the point where he didn't care what anybody else thought about him that day. He did not behave like a king that day. He behaved like a king's son, and Daddy was coming home. Overwhelmed, he danced in his underwear. What would you guys do if I started taking my... I got boxers on, all right? But you see, Michal, Saul's daughter, was embarrassed by David's actions. While David showed abandonment, Michal exhibited the pride of life. Could Michal have looked out the window, seen the ark, and become so excited about the returning presence of God that she would hurry down and join the celebration with David? Was she more consumed with God, or was she more consumed with David? How do you come to worship? More consumed with somebody in the church who ignored you this week, who didn't call you this week, who didn't say hello last week? Or do you come with your attention riveted on God? Do you come hoping they're going to sing your favorite song today and miff because they didn't? Or do you come and sing the words of all of them which honor, praise, and glory to God? That's what this is about. The heart of this passage is about the heart of the person. You can either dance in the presence of God, or you can despise others in the presence of God. Choice is yours. The choice was Michael's. Our heart should be surrendered and then submitted to God. With many different lines drawn over the expression of worship, we often place too much focus and at times judgment on outward displays of praise. We must first understand that worship is about how much we love and give devotion to God with our minds and our hearts. Someone in quiet meditation can be just as deep in adoration of God as ones whose hands are lifted up and voices singing, and vice versa. True worship should be a reflection of the heart of the believer. Let me wrap this up with these thoughts. To whom or what do you attribute the most worth in your own life? 2, is the location of your worship confined to geographic place and time, or do you worship freely in the power of the Spirit in accordance with the truth anywhere and everywhere? And let's bring it really personal. Do you relate more today with David or Michal? As you've come to this place of worship today, when we stand in the presence of a holy God, as David did and as Jesus invited the woman at the well to do, our hearts will be quick to give Him authority and honor that He deserves. The growing practice of worship will then create an overarching hunger for greater depth in all of the practices, but it will start with worship. I believe Tozer was right. Worship is the missing jewel of the church. Have you found it? Did you even know it was lost? Let's pray. Our Father, life gets so busy. Stuff gets so big. Things become so important that we believe in our head that you alone are worthy of worship, and yet it's you alone who often misses out on our worship. I pray that you will help each of us learn what worship is and how to be engaged in it as we move the truth from our head to disciplines of the heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a great afternoon.